Great catch, homie.
Pocket Protectors Podcast. I am your host, Jayson Brown. You can find me on Twitter at BrownJayson, joined by the crew, the fellas. Dr. Eric Eager, what's going on, my man? How you doing?
Hey, Jayson. I know you're a Canadian, but happy Thanksgiving in advance.
Thanks, bro.
Things are going well here. Nice and easy work night. And yeah, looking forward to the Vikings game tomorrow.
And I will say this, while I am Canadian and I am back in, you know, my native land, because I spent so much of my life living in America, I'm also celebrating Thanksgiving this week. So this was my last day of work this week, and I'll be off watching Vikings and the rest of the games tomorrow. And then Friday, probably just not doing anything at all, because why not?
Good man.
Yeah, got to do it. Also, we get a lot more vacation up here than most of y'all down there, so you got to use it somehow. Why not? You know, use it recreating all the fun memories of my childhood. Luke, how's it going? You know, I figure we need to get you in here because, you know, you got a busy day ahead of you. So what's going on, my man? What you got on deck?
It's going well. I really hope that there's at least one person listening to this instead of talking to their family. Like, I want to provide that service to someone who really needs it.
If you have family members that you do not agree with politically, listen to the Pocket Protectors Podcast instead.
Yeah. Do that. Exactly. Do that. That is an outstanding public service announcement from the Pocket Protectors Podcast. And real quick before we get into today's topic, I wanted to ask you guys just one question because we did talk about offensive line. And one of the things people have kind of, you know, thrown around a lot in recent days is that the Vikings now have an elite offensive line, in large part because, you know, we're not taking sacks at the ridiculous rate that we have over the past couple of seasons. So I guess I wanted to, you know, throw it to Eric first, Luke next. Is that an accurate statement? Like, can we firmly say that we are now amongst the NFL elite when it comes to offensive line play?
You know, I think when it comes to Pro Football Focus grades, it's probably, we got to probably pump the brakes a little bit, you know, with, for example, Nick Easton, we talked about last week, which was, I thought pretty cool, talking about the importance of left guard. But for what it's worth, Nick Easton is not grading particularly well at left guard. Pat Elflein, I think, has improved, but his, you know, season of work is not the greatest among the league. And then, yeah, you have pretty good tackle play in Remmers, Reef, and Rashad Hill, who's been very good at pass protection, not quite as good in run blocking, and Joe Berger's solid. I think one of the statistics that you can sort of point to sort of add to the discussion is that Case Keenum is currently the least sacked individual in the league on his pressures. So it's something like only 3 or 4% of the time he's pressured does he actually take a sack. And that is lowest in the league. So they are giving up some pressure, but Case Keenum has somehow been good at avoiding being taken down on those plays. And I think that's kind of, you know, spoken to some of the things maybe Luke has said, which is, you know, a lot of the pressure that a quarterback takes or the sacks a quarterback takes is on him more than it is on his line.
Yeah, I think it's generally, it's not perfect, but it's a nice kind of estimate line you can draw where like a pressure is on the offensive line, but once it turns into a sack, you can generally credit the quarterback for like either not getting rid of the ball or not being able to escape. Yeah. And I think I ran this number like 3 weeks ago and I haven't looked at it since, and it was 5% 3 weeks ago and he hasn't taken any sacks. So now it's gone down. But 3 weeks ago, the next best was Philip Rivers at 9% and nobody else was under 10. And most quarterbacks were around like 15%. So that 3 to 4% that Case Keenum is taking on it of sacks on his pressured plays is like leads the league in by a wide, wide margin, which is either elite and astounding or entirely unsustainable. So we'll see how that plays out down the season. But in terms of our offensive line, yeah, I think calling them elite is a little bit of an overstatement. It's like they've been solid, and I think they've been somewhere in the 10 to 12 range, which is astounding considering where they were last year. I also think as Vikings fans, we're a little bit too used to watching, you know, immediate pressure on like half the plays. So we should probably like raise our expectations back to normal, but we have like a normal to above average offensive line, which is amazing. And I don't really think they particularly need to be elite, but you know, there are other teams out there that just get less pressure on their quarterbacks and generally give their quarterbacks more time to throw and give better lanes for their running backs and everything. This isn't a perfect group by any stretch of the imagination.
Yeah. Well, and I guess
go ahead. Well, I think one of the things that to remember too, is I think we talked about this last week as well, the benefits of going from being far below average to average, I think are better than going from average to elite. And so when you look at a Vikings offensive line, so they were 23rd last year in pass blocking efficiency, despite having a quarterback that got rid of the ball in 2.45 seconds. Now they're eighth or ninth, and the quarterback's getting rid of the ball in like 2.6, 2.7 seconds, right? So not only is that number better, but in context, it's far better. But, you know, going from 25th or 23rd or whatever to 10th or 8th or 9th is worth a ton. Going from 8th or 9th to 1st is not nearly worth as much. And I think that that's like, you know, when fans are like, whoa, we've seen so much benefit from the Vikings offensive line improving this season, or the scheme or the quarterback play in confluence with the offensive line, we're more, you know, reticent to go, oh my gosh, they must be elite, when in reality they're just reaping the benefits of average or above average.
Yeah, I will take average.
Take it for 10 years. Let's go.
I will take it. But I think that the other thing that I find funny of this, and you know, JR and I have had conversations about this kind of in the other group messages or on other podcasts, is because we did see that big jump in the offense, is performing so much better now that we have improved the offensive line to, you know, average or a bit above average. Now there's just this kind of drumbeat that, hey, let's keep adding elite pieces to that offensive line as we move forward. Because obviously, based on the jump that we saw, you know, from terrible to average, you know, if we go from average to elite, then, you know, the Vikings will be an unstoppable unit. And so there's a lot of mocks out there that, even with as well as we're playing, have us taking, you know, some even have us taking tackles, which seems crazy, but there's a lot of mocks out there that have us taking, you know, guards. And then I thought it was very funny, left guards in particular, with our first round draft pick. And, you know, had a little back and forth with Eric about it on Twitter, but I guess, what would be your thoughts if the Vikings were to go in that direction, you know, come draft time in 2018, Eric?
Yeah, I mean, you have to ask the question about marginal value, right? Like, so for me, the marginal value of going from, yeah, I don't know, Case Keenum to Teddy Bridgewater might be a little higher than going from, you know, Nick Easton to, you know, above average to elite left guard, right? Going from, I don't know, Trey Waynes has played well this year. I'm not going to, you know, knock him, but going from like Trey Waynes to an elite level cornerback, I think the benefits, as Jacksonville's figuring out, like last season, Jacksonville was top five in the league in yards allowed per play with guys like Prince Amukamara and Devon House, right? They go from those guys to AJ Boye, and now they're the best defense in the NFL with the Vikings probably, right? You know, even for something like, you know, an edge defender, going from, you know, having your third edge defender being Brian Robinson to somebody maybe a little bit more impactful, I think the benefit there is probably higher than going from any of one of their linemen to who they have now. Now, I think it's a little different if somebody like Mike Remmers is a younger guy with a lower contract. Same with Reef. Because then you can kind of bring a guy in and compete and let the best guy win. But the realities of their contracts are such that if they're on the Vikings roster, they're going to be front runners to start, right? So the same might not be true about Nick Easton, but I think having like an established person there, you know, makes you a little bit less ready to sort of stir the pot. I mean, we saw it with Alex Boone, right? Like they brought Elfline in. and once Boone was going to, or once Alflein was going to start, Boone was kind of out the door. And so I don't necessarily know if drafting a guy that high, given how well the offensive line has gelled and their kind of continuity, even with their flaws, I don't necessarily see the benefit there that high.
Yeah, that makes sense. And I guess one of the other places that people have kind of pointed to, especially, you know, Dalvin Cook went down, you know, relatively early in the season. And so since he went down, we've seen a bit of a drop off in our success rate and in our ability to run the ball as consistently as maybe we were able to when we had Dalvin Cook. And so that's one of the things sometimes people point to. And, you know, that's also, you know, the thing that I wanted to have us kind of have a conversation about, you know, today, because it's something that we talk about a lot. As football fans in general, Vikings fans in particular, especially because we did have Adrian Peterson as the face of the franchise for so long, it's the running back position. And so I wanted to have you guys here, and we'll actually kick this one off with Luke, because Luke wrote a really, really awesome piece about Latavius Murray, which really, you know, got me thinking about some things. And of course, I loved it because it aligned with kind of my general thinking before reading it. So there's probably some confirmation bias going on there as well. But I guess, Luke, break down the article. Tell us what you were going for there. And then we can kick off this conversation about RBs.
Yeah, I guess I just wanted to, like, address the general fan idea that, like, Latavius Murray is suddenly this, you know, top 15, top 10 running back, which is an idea I've seen thrown around, which is kind of crazy. Because, you know, it got me thinking about, like, how to evaluate running backs and, like, what you're actually asking a running back to do. And when we look at, like, yards or even yards per carry or something like success rate, both of which are pretty predictive, they're still kind of less about the running back himself and more about the running game as a whole, which is probably why they're predictive, right? Because they're taking into account, like, you know, your offensive line play. And that if you have a bad offensive line, it's probably predictable that, like, you're going to struggle. But, like, in terms of just evaluating Latavius Murray himself and whether or not it's, you know, behooves the Vikings to look for a replacement or to start Jerick McKinnon more or whatever, a replacement, like, long-term, I mean. I looked mostly at, like, his ability to create after the play, which comes down to, like, forcing missed tackles and then, like, yards after contact and stuff. And I used Pro Football Focus's elusive rating. And in all of those categories of, I think there were, like, 48 qualifying running backs, Latavius Murray is, like, 44th and 41st. And he's very much near the bottom of the pack in all of those categories, which means that when you see a game like his game against the Rams, where he got 95 yards, 2 touchdowns, those are pretty misleading in terms of, like, how much we can trust him in situations going forward. You know, when, like, hey, we need a really good first down run here and it's a clutch situation and blah, blah, blah. Like, it's hard to trust him because you're essentially asking the offensive line to do the whole play for you when Latavius Murray can't create on his own. So if you go read the article, you can see a lot more, like, in-depth breakdown of that. But essentially, he's just not very creative after what the offensive line and play design have gotten him, which to me, like, any running back can take what the offensive line and play design can get you outside of the, you know, the odd Trent Richardson, you know, outlier. So that's why I kind of wanted to pump the brakes on the Tay train. It just doesn't seem like a guy who is able to create on his own. Just kind of seems like a human with a pulse who can carry a ball into the space that's opened up for him.
He's very fast. And, you know, so, you know, I jokingly call him Expensiata in the offseason. And it's not because I think he is as bad as Matt Asiata. It's because, you know, for as fast as Latavius Murray is, like Luke said, he isn't particularly, I guess, agile maybe would be the word I would use. And his running back instincts aren't great. And so if it's blocked up for him, he will hit it at a very high rate of speed and likely either break off a long touchdown, even though it seems some of his explosiveness or maybe long speed has failed a little bit because he did get caught from behind. But he isn't like, you know, a Dalvin, that if there's something that's not there, he's going to be able to create space for himself, which is something that you have seen. And neither is Jerick McKinnon for, you know, he might be a little bit better than Latavius Murray.
He's like a little bit better,
but he's not, you know, on a Dalvin level, which is something you've definitely seen play out from a success rate standpoint. I mean, Dalvin, I think, is still, you know, in the top 10 of success rate for running backs. I mean, I think he was sitting at 54% or something like that, whereas, you know, Latavius and Jet, you know, hover in the low 40s. But a lot of what Luke just said there in terms of how important the offensive line and all of the other pieces around the running back really are, really made me question, like, how valuable is that position at all in and of itself if so much of the success or failure of that position is about everything else that's going on outside of the position? So I guess, Eric, I guess from what you've been able to research or look into, I guess, how vital is it that a team has a great running back or a great individual player at running back for them to be successful? And how much of a running back success is tied to kind of the surrounding things and everything going on with the rest of the team?
Yeah, one of the cool things that we did at PFF kind of right in August going into the season was write up some of our research in a journal. And what was cool is, like, I always wanted to know, like, how stable some of these metrics are. So I know Luke talked about the elusive rating and things like that. And you know, I actually took a dive in there, wrote up some stuff. And, you know, so looking at things like, you know, so Luke talked about elusive rating. And what's interesting about elusive rating is its correlation to yards per carry is actually insignificant, right? So at the, you know, statistical significance, guys who are elusive, breaking tackles, all that kind of stuff in our metric system, they don't necessarily translate to having good yard per carry averages one season to the next at the player level. Additionally, you know, things like breakaway percentage, you know, one of our other tools sort of talks about how many yards you get on 15 yard or more runs, also not particularly correlated to yards per carry one year. However, like, you know, when you drill down, PFF run blocking grades, so looking at basically plus minus grades across the team, are the most are more correlated than anything the running back does in the PFF system. They translate to winning games or scoring points more than anything else in the PFF system, and they correlate as well with yards per carry as anything else. And that is, you know, sort of adjusting for things like how well the offensive line does and all of that kind of thing. In fact, the thing that the running back does that is the most predictive year to year in terms of team points scored offensively is yards per route run. So whether you're an efficient receiver out of the backfield, the Chris Thompsons, the, you know, going back in the Vikings lore, my favorite, Amp Lee, you know, guys like Chuck Foreman, you know, guys that could catch the ball out of the backfield, that is actually, you know, the most stable thing. So I was trying to sort of drill down, okay, let's take away from the running back, you know, the things that help him. And ultimately, elusive rating is pretty stable year to year, correlation coefficient, something like 0.4. But in terms of, like, actually helping out an offense, having that kind of elite level running back talent is actually not that important. In fact, if you're going to have an elite level running back at doing something, catching the ball is actually sort of the most predictive thing in terms of scoring points year to year.
One thing I think I found is interesting about that is, like, as we're seeing with, like, Murray and some of the other, like Orleans Darkwa and some of these other teams that have poor running backs. And it seems like, you know, if the elusive rating doesn't have much of a correlation to, like, actual success, that means that running backs who are bad at those things doesn't have a huge impact on your team. And this whole position kind of feels like the inverse of offensive line, where, like, a below average, like going from a bad running back to an average running back doesn't make a huge difference, but going from an average running back to, like, an extremely productive one can, with, like, Lev Bell or Zeke Elliott, that can, like, actually change your game, or LaDainian Tomlinson, that can change your game through receiving and stuff. So that's why I think it's kind of hard to get across the point. Like, the Latavius Murray article got a lot of ire from people being like, what do you mean the running game's fine? And it is fine, and it just has nothing to do with him.
Yeah, I mean, Murray right now out of 48 qualifying running backs is 41st in elusive rating, which takes into consideration running and receiving. He's right around the guy you just described, Orleans Darkwa, but also Todd Gurley is 39th, right? And so you look at, like, what has really changed in Los Angeles. You know, Gurley averaged, I think, less than a yard maybe per carry before contact last year. It was egregious, right? Yeah. And Todd Gurley, if anybody plays fantasy and owns Todd Gurley, has seen, like, he's had a good year, right? But is that more because John Sullivan's always been a good run-blocking center, now he's with them? Andrew Whitworth is a very good left tackle, now he's with them. Their offense is schemed better, right? Are they just getting Todd Gurley more yards per carry before contact? And that's probably more like the case. Ezekiel Elliott's 37th, right? And that kind of speaks to sort of what I'm talking about, which is, you know, a lot of the guys with elusive ratings that are pretty high right now are guys who are having success, like LeGarrette Blount, Deion Lewis, Kareem Hunt, Alvin Kamara. But that it's not necessarily as stable year to year. And I think most importantly, and I think this gets down to Jason's question, is depending on a running back who is elusive for your offense's success, aka the Miami Dolphins with the Jay Ajayi, is not a formula for success, right? So Jay Ajayi last year was fantastic. His elusive rating was sort of off our charts. He got a lot of unblocked yards, and the Dolphins profited off of it. But having that as your offensive philosophy, as this data shows, is not a stable year-to-year means by which to have offensive success.
There's like a limit to the impact it can have, no matter how good it is.
Yep, and it's fleeting.
Yeah, and I think that you raised a really great point there, especially bringing up Todd Gurley, and that one of the biggest changes for him, you know, this year versus last year is how much he's getting usage in the passing game, which was something that, you know, anyone who watched him in college knew that he was capable of doing as a prospect, that he just was used very sparingly as when he came to the pros. And so he's getting so much more usage in the passing game, which is getting him into space and letting him use some of his natural athleticism there. But like you said, that having that running back that is able to, you know, catch passes is that thing that really opens up the offense, because in almost every situation, you know, the pass is more valuable to your offense than that run.
Yep. Yeah,
chain management, like staying ahead of the chains and success rate and stuff, that's really where the impact of a running game can be. But that's like, okay, cool, you got, you know, your 4 or 5 yards on first down. Okay, now let's turn to the passing game to like actually move the ball and create most of like the actual expected points and the actual production. And the running back just has to be a part of that.
Yeah, and I think whether that be, and this is where I think I'll push back a little bit on McKinnon and kind of, you know, in terms of, I actually do think he's been an effective player for Minnesota. Both, you know, he's averaging just as many yards after contact as Cook so far. He's averaging about a yard and a half per route run, which is kind of in the middle-ish to the high end, of, you know, kind of like the top 60th percentile among running backs. So that's a pretty big thing. I know, you know, Cook struggled to catch the ball early. I think we all project him to be a pretty good all-around back. Now, does that necessarily mean that the Vikings extend McKinnon after the year? I think that's a really good question. But I think he's been a, you know, and frankly, I think this speaks to what we've discussed privately, which is that Pat Shurmur is just doing a fantastic job in sort of using his backs to the best of their ability. You know, one of the reasons Latavius Murray has looked good, I think, is because he, like many other Vikings players, including McKinnon and including Cook, are hardly ever put in a position where they look bad, where they're incapable of doing what they're asked to do and that kind of thing. And so, you know, when Luke comes out and writes an article and says, well, you know, Latavius Murray isn't that good, I think, you know, that's fair. And I also think that it's like, well, and Pat Shurmur knows that and doesn't put him in positions to do ungood things that many times.
I should have titled that article, Latavius Murray isn't very good and that doesn't matter.
Yeah. That's well,
and really doesn't make any difference.
Yeah, and I think, you know, Oakland figured out the same thing last year, right? They used DeAndre Washington and Jalen Richard and in ways that complimented Murray. And so Murray, you know, that offense did not really skip a beat by having him somewhat struggle last season. So, you know, I think running backs like him are going to have jobs in the league for a long time. They're going to be on, you know, paid accordingly, but that does, it's like Keenum, right? I mean, Keenum's going to have a job in the NFL for 10 more years after this year. That doesn't necessarily mean he's hashtag good, but it does mean he'll be employed for sure.
I'm pretty excited about kicking off the next Ryan Fitzpatrick.
That's some shade. Although Fitzpatrick is what, 2-1 as a starter, 2-0 as a starter in Tampa.
Hey, he had a couple great. Yeah, he had that 2015 year. I can't wait to see Case Keenum be a journeyman for like 8 different teams and almost make the playoffs on a couple of them.
Yeah, they should have locked the Vikings should have locked Keenum up for 3 years, $15 million. You know, 3 weeks ago, probably now he'll. He'll command Brian Hoyer money. Who knows?
Yeah, he's going to go to Jacksonville. taken to the playoffs.
Oh, God.
I will say, I think just because you brought up McKinnon and extending him, and then also there's Latavius Murray, who has options on his contract and can theoretically be cut with no dead money. I think in light of the conversation we just had, I think that's a pretty heavy indictment of the value of these guys in general, not necessarily because their skill sets are like problematic and they need to be purged from the team and cut away, but more because those contracts are going to be, you know, 3 to 4 times more expensive than the contracts of somebody who can perform those duties exactly the same way. And if we can have an offense that is successful in spite of the running back not being very good, and we can afford to put them in positions that don't care if they're good or not, we can do that with anyone, and we don't need to pay Latavius Murray, you know, his $4 million, and pay Jerick McKinnon whatever money he's hit, the $4 million he commands. You know, we can allocate that somewhere else. I think it's just kind of a general like supply and demand thing. There's just so many good running backs coming out of college that you can pick up a Kareem Hunt in the fourth round and have your running game just be like totally fine. And that's not Alvin. Kareem Hunt isn't really an outlier. There's Tariq Cohen, there's Jordan Howard, there's Jay Ajayi. Like all of these guys are
Kamara.
Alvin Kamara, Austin, yeah, Eckler, all of these guys.
Marlon Mack.
So speaking of Alvin Kamara, because I mean, generally speaking, when you say something like, you know, this individual skill of the running back isn't all that important, you'll get pushback from people. But you know, that Saints offense has basically been just a factory for running back production over the last, well, basically since Drew Brees and Sean Payton have been there. I mean, Tim Hightower, you know, came off the street and won a bunch of people fantasy championships a couple of years ago. So, you know, all of this to really ask, what does it mean that Tim Hightower off the street was able to have success in the Saints offense and Adrian Peterson was not?
He washed.
You know, I think it's about a skill set, right? I think having the ability to catch the football, having the ability to make plays when you're not a constant featured part of the offense, I think those are the types of players that succeed. And like, we as Vikings fans are having a hard time dealing with that with McKinnon and with Murray, and like, because we've never seen a running back have success when he's kind of picking his spots, right? But now we have, you know, McKinnon can catch the ball, Murray's okay, I guess, whatever. But if you look at, like, for example, like the top guys in the NFL in yards per route run, you got guys like Rex Burkhead, who's kind of he can do a lot of stuff. Alvin Kamara catching the ball, Chris Thompson, Tariq Cohen, James White, Duke Johnson. They're all guys who can kind of split out, play some wide receiver. And, you know, Matt Forte is even in that list, Theo Riddick, those kind of guys. I think it's a skill set issue with Peterson, just simply didn't develop that skill set. Maybe never was capable of it either, but certainly never developed it.
The league kind of evolved around him. He was always a fairly low success rate player, but with enough explosive plays where it made it worth it, you know, and that's where the whole famine feast trope came from. But when the explosive plays stopped coming because he lost his acceleration and his burst from just aging and then like spending a couple, you know, missing 2014, missing 2016, he lost a lot of that explosive burst. So then what used to be the big explosive plays suddenly cut back from 70-yard touchdown to like, oh, solid 15-yard run. And then it's like famine, I guess a 15-yard burst twice a game, and that no longer became worth it. And he didn't develop other skills to like compensate for that loss in production. So if you're a head coach, it's like a volume argument. You just can't put him in for as many snaps without it being a tell to the defense. And then when you're losing those blocking snaps and those passing snaps by like ratio, you have to lose some of those rushing snaps that then start going to, you know, Ingram and Kamara, who then just started out playing him because he's old. But if you can't get those, you know, enough of a sample, quote unquote, in a game to unlock some of those big plays, because those big plays are no longer worth it, you kind of lose like all of your value. And that's kind of why he's not really having that much success in Arizona now. He's had like a couple games, but then he has somewhere he's like 21 carries for 29 yards, because those explosive plays don't come around anymore. And when they do, their value is just so much lower than they were in like 2008 and 2009 and, you know, 2012.
And so I guess really the last question that I had, you know, about the position is because I feel like, I guess we'll say like analytics, Twitter or numbers folks have been calling out, you know, that the running back position isn't particularly valuable for a while. And I feel like, I mean, the real NFL would have to kind of see that when you do see a person like, you know, a Tim Hightower come in and just plug into a system, you know, and have success because so many things are good in that system. I guess, you know, I'll start with Eric on this one. I guess, why is it that, you know, every year, every college football season, every draft season, we still end up having running backs that get, you know, ridiculously hyped up. And then we still have things like, you know, a Leonard Fournette who gets drafted to a team that already had two capable running backs. They draft him, you know, in the top five. You have Ezekiel Elliott's getting drafted over Jalen Ramsey's. Like, given all of this evidence that shows how much more valuable these other positions are and how less likely you are to find these other positions at later points in the draft, why is it that every year we get ourselves wrapped up in, you know, who's better, Barkley or Geis, or the name is escaping me, but the running back from you know, Notre Dame or Stanford? Like, why do we still care so much about this position if the position isn't one that is actually that valuable?
Well, I think the position is actually fairly valuable in college. I haven't run the numbers, but I think that that's what's driving it too, is like we all care about, like, whether we're Gophers fans or whatever fans, right? Like, we're worried about like that team winning, right? And then so we all see that Saquon Barkley has like this huge impact on his college team and these changing games. And we're, you know, same thing with quarterback play too. Like, we see, you know, Tim Tebow, you know, win national championships for Florida. And we won, you know, we see him have a huge impact on the college game, and we're enticed into thinking he can have a similar impact on the pro game, even though I think all of us would know that, like, you know, even though, you know, some, you know, I was somewhat of a fan of his back in the day, but we, like, all in hindsight know that, like, that type of quarterback play doesn't win. Same thing with, like, Johnny Manziel. Same thing with, like, you know, other quarterbacks for which, you know, skill sets do not translate to the pros. So I think it's somewhat that is, it's like we watch college football. It's a different game. We see sort of impacts there, and then we assume that impacts there will translate. I would push back, though. I mean, like, there was this article by 538. I think I just pulled it up, looking at, like, the average pay for top positions. So the 16th highest paid players at each position. And literally every position, whether you go from quarterback to offensive line to tight end, are either linear growth over time for the top players in terms of pay or exponential growth even. And running back is basically flat. So running backs have not seen an increase in their average cap value per year since, you know, 2000 to now. And so I think, like, the league in that sense is catching up. And then I think the ace in the hole really has been, and you can see this kind of dip actually in the data in 538, is right around 2011 when the CBA came out, and, you know, the amount of money that the top draft picks made was severely stunted, right? So, you know, if you draft a running back in the top four, he's not going to be automatically the top paid position player at his position. Like, you know, for example, Eric Berry, when he was drafted in 2010, he was the top paid safety in the entire NFL at that moment, right? Fifth overall. So, you know, you're seeing something like that. And even then, right, you look at the running back pay scale right now and over the cap, Leonard Fournette is the fifth highest paid running back on a year-to-year basis. Ezekiel Elliott's about 10th or 11th. You know, and so, but you look at the average pay per year, Le'Veon Bell is on the franchise tag, so he's kind of thrown out there, but you have Devontae Freeman at about $8 million a year, LeSean McCoy at about $8 million, Doug Martin about $7 million. Then you get down to Fournette. And so, like, those guys, you know, it is not as valuable. And even among the players for which, you know, a lot of money has been bestowed on them, you know, guys like Bell and Freeman and McCoy are all guys that catch the ball in the backfield. They do more than just run the football. So, I don't know. I think that the NFL is starting to catch up to this idea. And I think the CBA – The way that the contracts are sort of bestowed upon the players once they're drafted has really sort of helped them get drafted higher, even when that does not necessarily seem like the sound analytical decision to make.
Is it like when you take a Fournette or you take an Elliott, like top five, because of that pay scale thing and because you can get away with like paying an elite player less, doesn't that make that asset like way more valuable though? And now you're spending this asset that's like way heightened in value since the new CBA, and you're spending it on a position where it may not give you that return. Like, you can get Ezekiel Elliott for cheap, or you can get Jalen Ramsey for relatively cheap amongst cornerbacks. So I feel like, while I do agree, like the contract in contracts, teams you can tell are like catching up to the idea that running backs might not be that valuable. But I think part of what makes them still get drafted so high is an inability to like to understand that like those skills don't really translate to the NFL just because the game is different. But I also don't think it's particularly blasphemous to say that like teams are pretty bad at prioritizing, and teams in the draft kind of are just firing in the dark. And I don't know who isn't firing in the dark in the draft, but you know, you see teams doing these perpetually stupid things all the time, drafting kickers, drafting Adam Shaheen in the second round, you know, drafting Christian Hackenberg, even though there was mounds and mounds of evidence that he wasn't going to be good. So it's like in the draft, it's such a weird thing. And most GMs, you know, if a GM's only going to last 5 or 6 years before getting fired, they only get 6 drafts to learn. So just the way the NFL is set up and the way that like the culture and the system is set up, I don't think it's particularly blasphemous to be like, yeah, NFL teams are just making a bad decision all the time.
Yeah, I think so. My only pushback to that, I do agree that like assuming that NFL teams are making sound decisions is a faulty assumption. But I will say you have to think about risk reward. So when you sign a free agent, the likelihood that that player is going to be as good or in the same ballpark as he was prior to that contract is higher than it is for a draft player. You see what I'm saying? So,
yeah.
But I do think the distribution is narrower for running backs. So because the position of running back is fairly, I don't know, if the environment is good, the running back generally produces. I know there's the Trent Richardsons of the world and everything like that. But most of the time you're going to get competent play there. Whereas like you're going to have the Barcadius Mingos and the Deion Jordans and the, I'm trying to think of a cornerback that was drafted high that wasn't very good. We've had a couple, Lattimore and Ramsey have been great, but like that's my only comeback is, and we'd have to run the numbers on this, but like, you know, running back is maybe more of a sure play early on. But I don't know. I'm not exactly sure. I do know that Elliott behind a Cowboys offensive line is probably a pretty sure play, whereas a guy like Ramsey in a defensive scheme that may or may not be as good might not be as sure of a play. But we all have the benefit of hindsight here.
That makes a lot of sense. And teams are definitely like, they do tend to skew conservatively when those decisions pop up. You know, we see that a lot in game with like not going for it on fourth down when maybe they should, or not going for 2-point conversions when maybe they should.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like that. I think that whole conversation there about how teams view risk might be one that we take up on another podcast, because I also think that's interesting in that you do sometimes have those competing priorities when you do get to the draft. If you're the GM on a team that, you know, you're drafting high because your team wasn't very good. So to Eric's point, maybe the better player or the player who could help you longer term is a riskier play. So maybe you pass on the Jalen Ramsey to get the guy that you know is going to get you kind of points with the owner and the fans right away, which Zeke Elliott definitely did coming right out the gate. That was a great pick. Everyone, you know, looking at that, you know, thinks that was a marvelous pick for them. And then, you know, you get to this year, Doug Free retires, the line isn't as good, Zeke isn't as dominant, and then, you know, all the other stuff that happens. But I think that is a fascinating conversation, especially as it relates to the draft. It's sometimes those priorities that especially on bad teams, GMs may have competing priorities and may not always make the best long-term decision for the team in the hopes that they make a short-term decision that may help them keep getting that really big paycheck. So I think
a cultural element.
Yeah, I think we've pretty much covered everything that I had in terms of the running backs. I guess, was there anything else you guys wanted to talk about? Plug, anything like that before we get out of here?
Check out my Latavius Murray article. go yell at me in the comments like many people have.
Yeah, if you're yelling at your family, go yell at Luke.
I think one of the blessings that PFF gave to us was stop having a comment section, I think, a year ago. So, because, I'll be battling with those people trying to be nice. And, of course, as you've seen with me on Twitter, sometimes I go from being a nice guy to being kind of a jerk. So, we have on PFF, we have the PFF ELO ratings. The Vikings are now eighth. So they've made their first or second, I think, trip to the top 10. I think before them you have New England, Philadelphia, Pittsburgh, New Orleans, Carolina, Atlanta, Kansas City, I think, ahead of them. So, I think Minnesota has maybe a little bit of a case to make to be maybe top five, but we certainly like them. We have the PFF spread picks. We already have the ones for Thanksgiving up. We like Detroit to cover. Minnesota's 3-point favorites on the road. We like Detroit to at least cover that, which might not be, the best thing for all to hear. But I did say last week that Minnesota would cover against the Rams, and they did. So I don't know. You're welcome. I don't know. And we have the PFF spread picks coming out for the entire week on Friday morning. So go ahead and take a look at those. We had a decent week last week, so we're happy.
You can also check out Purple PTSD's Twitter page. I live tweet all the games. I'm going to be live tweeting this Thanksgiving game. Probably we'll have to check out around the third quarter due to Thanksgiving festivities, but I will at least be live tweeting most of it.
All caps?
Pretty much always, yeah.
Okay,
just good. Unbridled, raw, informationless emotion.
Why is Teddy not in? There's 2 minutes left in the third quarter, and the Vikings have 7 points. I mean, never mind. They won. Sorry. There's no reason that they should put in Teddy.
Oh, man. So
not till Case gives him a reason.
Yeah, that's a whole other podcast, y'all. Well, gentlemen, thank you once again. Luke, if you haven't packed already, I hope you've packed already. But if you haven't packed already, throw those stuff in the duffel bag. And go get ready to sit in traffic so that you can fly across the country, man.
I'm looking forward to the next 12 hours of my life.
Yeah, I'm sure that'll be good times. But make sure you get enough rest so that you can appropriately live tweet the game for all of us.
It might be a little loopy.
Okay. Well, all right, gentlemen. thanks again. Y'all have a good one.